It wouldn't be much of a C4ISRNET conference without space talk, specifically buying in this case, something services each had to do before Space Force. In this segment, reporter Nathan Strout spoke to General David Thompson, the Space Force's Vice Chief of Space Operations, and asked him if acquisition is getting easier with a new service.
You know, one of the arguments for the creation of the Space Force was that it would help unify space acquisitions under one organization, right? Do you think Space Force has largely done that with the establishment of Space Systems Command, or is that something that needs to come still, or is that less a priority under the Space Force at this point in time?
It absolutely remains a priority. In fact, probably, as you said, still one of the top priorities in for the Space Force and for the nation. This is the latest step in, and by no means are we close to done. There's still much more work to do. A couple of additional things, as you and I think probably most of the audience members know, we are still working on elements of an alternative acquisition process that Congress has requested of us. We've been working it now for a couple of years with the Department of Defense, with OMB, and with members of Congress. The reorganization and the new structure for Space Systems Command helps that, but there's more work to do. Some of those elements of the approach that we're proposing, we've already implemented. We've pushed responsibility down to program managers. We've implemented we've provided them a head of contracting and contracting authority down to that level to be able to speed that. But there's more work to do.
The Space Development Agency is working on the National Defense Space Architecture, a network of mostly low-orbit satellites to help the DoD move data through space. The agency's director spoke at the conference about how the network benefits you, the warfighter.
We are joined today by Derek Tournier, director of the Space Development Agency. Established in 2019, the SDA has been charged with creating the National Defense Space Architecture, a proliferated space architecture that will eventually be made up of hundreds of satellites in low Earth orbit. Those satellites will pass data back and forth to each other through a mesh network enabled by optical inter-satellite links. To start us off, Dr. Tournier, could you explain what the transport layer is and how this on-orbit mesh network will benefit the warfighter?
Certainly. Thank you for the opportunity. So the mesh network and the transport layer, the whole idea is to be able to move data as rapidly as possible to get that tactical information directly to the warfighter. So what the transport layer consists of are hundreds of satellites that form a resilient, optically interconnected mesh network that will pass data directly to existing tactical data links. So what that means to the warfighter is the following. I can now move data from a targeting cell that could be located CONUS, or ideally that targeting cell will actually form a target on board on the satellites, and I can send that data down directly to an existing tactical data link on a weapons platform or on a weapon itself. So if you actually look at what the department is trying to do with the CJAD-C2, the whole idea behind that is so that we have a way that we can close kill chains rapidly by being able to move data from sensors to target acquisition and formation, and then to the weapon system. The transport layer is the way that is done in space. The transport layer will tie all the CJAD-C2 networks for all the services together so that we can have this unified means to be able to provide information so we can do beyond line of sight targeting directly to a weapons platform, putting it directly in hands of the warfighter. So we have an optical communication standard community of interest where we have people from industry and across the government that are involved to help us come up with that optical standard. Space Force had representatives as part of that community of interest. So we were feeding data back and forth. And so their inputs helped shape that standard. Now they do have some satellites that obviously anything that is legacy or anything that is currently in build will not be able to talk to our satellites via that optical crosslink, just because it would be too large of an impact to put that onto their satellites now. However, the plan would be going forward that all military satellites would have a means to communicate directly with the transport layer as a way to move data around and then get data back and forth, not only to the ground, but then inter-satellite type communication. So we're working with the Space Force on their future programs to make sure that they have compatibility so that they can plug into the transport layer.
I want to talk a little bit more about that commercial aspect. So you're thinking that but in the 2024 timeframe, when Tranche 1 goes up, there will be some commercial satellites that can tie into the network. How many partners are you working with to tie into the mesh network, and what capabilities are they bringing in?
That's absolutely the goal. Absolutely. In 2024, that timeframe. So keep in mind, the Tranche 1 satellites will launch in 2024, and then they'll fly with a lifetime of notionally 5 years, right? So anything sure. that launches in that timeframe is, we're talking with commercial entities to be able to plug in. And so we're talking with, right now we have three commercial mission partners that we've been in discussions with, three or four, depending on how you count it. We've had discussions with more, but those three or four, we've had some pretty serious discussions where we've exchanged some technical information. And as far as the data, what are we looking at? So we're talking with, as I mentioned, our custody layer. Custody is our ISR layer. SDA is not building out any of those satellites. We're working with mission partners to actually build out those satellites and then put those data on the transport layer. And that would be essentially feed your targeting data. So we're talking with commercial partners that provide commercial electro-optical information, commercial SAR information, commercial SIGINT information on how we could get those data into the transport layer. Direct communication with optical crosslinks. Then we're also talking with commercial partners that provide, in essence, a high bandwidth data backhaul to say, now, how could we use the transport layer is specifically designed for the Department of Defense to make sure that we have positive command and control for our tactical targeting, you know, for wartime scenario. But how could we actually tie into other companies that are building out these mesh networks in space to have an alternative or a backup to make us more resilient as a means to be able to pass data off of the transport layer? So we've been talking with those kind of companies as well.
There was a lot of good conversations in that conference. C4ISRNET has regular conversations with the brightest minds in military innovation. The next installment of the Removing Stovepipe series is on Thursday and will explore the future of the Army's position, navigation, and timing systems. You can keep track of these live events on c4isrnet.com/newsletters.